We'd like to welcome all of you to our High Performer webinar. We're very excited today to have Dr. Marty Makary and a wonderful group of reactor panelists. What I'd like to do is just welcome all of you. I'm on slide two and move to slide three and just make sure that everyone has their audio function up. We've had more than 1,000 registrants today, and we probably are averaging 3 to 4 each, and not everybody will have good connections. So there are phone lines that are available for you if you do have problems, and you can see that on slide three, lower left-hand corner. On slide four, we address where you can get the slides and download a transcript of the slides and be able to watch and listen to the presentation after the fact in about 3 business days. And so we're on slide four, and that's on our website, our landing page, www.safetyleaders.org. In the upper right-hand corner, you can click on the webinar and be able to access that content. And on slide five, we have a picture of Dr. Makary and his book. And this is where you'll be able to download the content and be able to watch it in the future. On slide six, you may follow us hashtag safety leaders on Twitter and Facebook, as well as take advantage of the other linkages that we have for you. Our calling is to save lives, save money, and create value in the communities we serve. And we're really honored to have Marty speaking to us today about the impact that we can potentially have. Our disclosure statement is on slide eight. I won't belabor you by reading it, but you can go back and refer to it. And no educational grantor or anyone has any influence over us today in any way regarding any products or services. I'd like to turn it over to Janie Dingman and have her share a 20 or 30 second message to keep us grounded on patients and family members. Jenny has been a longtime patient advocate, wonderful champion team member of ours, and an author of patient safety articles with us at TMIT. Jenny?
Dr. Denham, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for being here for this exciting webinar. I'm really looking forward to hearing everything that's going on today, and I understand that there are a lot of people on this call, and I just want to thank each and every one of you and those of you in your facilities listening as a group. Thank you so much for taking your time today to listen to this very valuable webinar. And I'm just honored and humbled to be able to serve here today with Dr. Denham and Dr. Makary. Thank you so much, and Linda and everyone here. Dr. Denham, I'll turn it back to you.
Great, thank you. So not only do we have Dr. Makary, but we also have Linda Groh, the CEO of AORN, our fantastic nursing association of the perioperative nurses, as well as that we wish that we would have had Sharon Rosemark as a trustee who's had a recent catastrophic patient safety accident to a family member. And as we were recording her comments, it was just so close to the event that we're going to delay that in future, but this was a catastrophic infection event that struck her own family, and as a trustee offered tremendous new insights to her and really galvanized her resolve to focus on these areas of transparency that are so critical that we'll discuss today. Frank Yuto is our Chief Technology Officer at TMIT, and will be taking us through a series of 4 slides on Sharp's injuries to set Linda up to react to what she hears today. I will start off with just a few slides and address some critical issues in patient safety. This is a quick update. I want to remind you all what Net Promoter Score is. We ask you questions in our surveys to support strongly a statement. We'll have 5 or 6 polling questions at the partway through today or towards the end. And what we do is we subtract the detractors, those that give us a 1 or 1 through a 6. As to how strongly they may disagree with a statement or a question. Promoters are those that would highly support a statement that might give it a 9 or a 10, 10 being highest. And that when you subtract the detractors, 1 through 6, from your promoters, you get a net promoter score, which really is a terrific tool. It is the most commonly and most powerful tool in customer satisfaction. I'd like to remind our audience and those that are new that of the top 10 practice target areas that we're keeping our safety officers and safety leaders up at night, this is the review of net promoter score with surgical never events at the top. And you can see that we had very highly ranked areas that may not necessarily be part of the domains of our current safety officers. If we look at the never events and prevention of healthcare-associated infections, we basically have a net promoter score of 73, which is the highest we've seen for surgical never events, and 62 for healthcare-associated infections. So these are areas that are keeping you, our audience, up at night, and the net promoter score is actually showing us that 73% have great concern after you subtract those that have had that are the detractors. If we look at the next area, are the technology areas. And the new hazards in healthcare information technology that are growing are electronic healthcare record accidents that are occurring, and a 74 net promoter score, the highest we've ever seen. Interoperability failures, also a big issue, and inadequate reprocessing of endoscopic devices and surgical instruments. There appears to be a quiet epidemic of these multiple infections that are occurring in our procedural labs. And I think what we're seeing is that as hospitals are acquiring outpatient facilities and surgical facilities, they are acquiring huge risk that has really been unaccounted for in the system. And then our governance and administrative leaders are really at risk for their inaction because what we see is the risk identification and mitigation very high, as well as safety budget protection and governance training in patient safety. So these are areas that you have told us through the polling of our audience that are really, really critical. If we move to the NQF safe practices that apply to this area, it is the safe practice for the mitigation of risk and hazards that is absolutely critical. So these are areas you've told us that are absolutely of critical importance to you. We will be polling you regarding those later in our discussion, but I wanted to set Dr. Makary up with some of these numbers, which are from this, our audience. Dr. Makary is well known to all of us for his book, Unaccountable. He's doing terrific work in the area of transparency, patient safety, and quality. He's the surgical director of Johns Hopkins Pancreas Multidisciplinary Cancer Center Clinic. He is a specialist in minimally invasive pancreatobiliary surgery and director of the minimally invasive pancreas surgery area. We are really honored to have you, Marty. We know you're at an airport and took time away to really instruct this great audience. And we have about 3,000 to 4,000 people from 1,000 institutions on who will be learning from you. So I won't belabor your introduction and go ahead and turn it over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Chuck. And I just want to thank you for all your tremendous work in this field. And it's good to be on the call here with Jennifer and Linda Groh, of course, and Frank. I look forward to hearing him as well. So thanks for putting this together. What I'd like to talk about is something that many of you are very passionate about, and it's probably the reason why you're on this call is because this is a call among people who get it. And I want to talk about not the science of safety or the things that we've been working on that we're already familiar with, but instead the next steps in the area of improving medical care. We talk about patient safety, we talk about quality, but what is really going to drive things to progress in leaps and bounds? If we look at several of the reports that have come out, be it the January 2011 Landrigan study that came out in the New England Journal of Medicine, which showed there's been really no improvements in certain adverse safety events over 7 years in a large population, or a recent report by ARC, the OIG study, or even the NPR report that came out on September 20th, if you heard the NPR story, which asked the very important question, how many people really do die every year from medical mistakes? The answer they got from their analysis and their review and talking to experts was that the low end of the range is really around 210,000 people a year. And we throw around the number from the 1999 Institute of Medicine report. And in fact, that's the most highly cited article in the entire world medical literature. It's amazing because when you talk to the authors, and by the way, this slide is not a picture of one of the authors. If you talk to the authors, they will tell you it was a very crude interpolation. I mean, it was nursing home data. It was interpolated to U.S. hospitals. As you know, they're very different types of safety events. And we've been sort of talking about 100,000 lives a year. But if we look at this recent analysis that was reported by NPR just 3 weeks ago, the number's 210,000. Now, when I was in medical school, I remember one of my roommates watching TV, and he was listening to an interview of Bill Gates. And Bill Gates was asked a simple question, how much money do you have? And Bill Gates said, you know, it's abstract. It has no meaning. It's just out there. It's tied to the equity value of the company and so forth. And my roommate said, you know, that's how I feel about my debt. It's abstract. It has no meaning. And I think a lot of times whenever a group or an organization, if you look at industrial psychology, whenever they're focused on a certain endemic or problem in society, it can be difficult for them to actually quantify the magnitude of the problem proportional to other problems in society. And I want to do that briefly here, but by way of a background, this is Samuel Mudd. At the age of 17, Samuel Mudd enrolled at Georgetown College and later studied at the University of Maryland. His thesis was on dysentery or diarrhea, which at the time was the number three cause of death. Now, in about 1860 or so, he married his high school sweetheart, and her name was Sarah Dyer. Now, she was not excited to have her last name switched from Dyer to Mudd. But as a wedding gift to his father, they got 218 acres of farmland. Now, Dr. Mudd, because he could not support his family with a simple medical practice, which was common at the time, he did have a small-scale tobacco farm, and it was staffed by slaves. But in 1863, Lincoln, through the Emancipation Proclamation, abolished slavery, and Dr. Mudd was forced to spend a lot more time on the plantation. Many times, Dr. Mudd considered selling the plantation. Well, at one point, he met with a 26-year-old actor by the name of John Wilkes Booth. Booth, of course, became famous because later he was known as the assassin of President Lincoln. What's known about Wilkes Booth as the assassination, what's not so much known is that after he shot the president, he jumped out of the balcony, ran up the aisle in the theater, and walked out of Ford's Theater. Lincoln's bodyguard, incidentally, was across the street. Lincoln had one bodyguard, and he was a known alcoholic, and he was across the street at a bar. If you go to Ford's Theater today, there's still a bar across the street. Well, Wilkes Booth made it all the way across the Anacostia River outside of the city, and he met with this Dr. Mudd that he had previously met with. And he had a sprained ankle because when he jumped out of the theater, he had hurt his ankle and he had to limp out. So Dr. Mudd treated his ankle. Now, it's unknown whether or not Dr. Mudd knew that Booth had just assassinated the president. But Dr. Mudd was later put to trial for being a part of the conspiracy to assassinate the president of the United States. As a matter of fact, after Booth was captured far away from Washington, D.C., and the trials began, Dr. Mudd spent 14 years trying to clear his name. Now, Dr. Mudd was a respectable physician. Dr. Mudd stepped up to the call of duty to treat. But Dr. Mudd had a terrible time trying to clear his name, and that's where we get the term His name is Mud. Now, in Baltimore, a few miles down the street from the hospital where I work, one of the hospitals had one doctor allegedly put in over 300 unnecessary heart stents a couple years ago. Well, if you Google this hospital to this day, it still comes up with disparaging hits when you type in this hospital. Now, this is a good hospital. We've gotten to know the doctors there over the years, and there are good doctors there. There are good people there. There are good procedures there. There's an amazing heritage there. There's a phenomenal mission. But because one doctor basically went unchecked with little accountability, because there's minimal transparency in the line of work he does, he was able to do what he did with so many people involved before it blew up into a catastrophe for not only the patients but the hospital. Well, it turns out that AIG recently did a study asking hospital executives what is their number one priority and what is their number one fear in leading a hospital. Well, everybody says their number one priority now is patient safety, even though they define it entirely differently, and they identify different people as the ones responsible for patient safety at their hospital. Some people identify risk managers. Others identify nurses. Actually, nurses were the most, that was the most common answer. And the minority group identified as those responsible for patient safety are actually the physicians. Well, one thing that we've learned from this AIG study is that people have all kinds of different ideas about what patient safety is. And they have all different kinds of ideas as to whose responsibility it is. Now, when asked what is your number one fear as a hospital CEO, they identify financial sustainability. So it turns out what keeps hospital CEOs up at night is not only whether or not there's going to be a catastrophic outcome, but also whether or not their hospital is even going to be surviving in a year. Well, these are some catastrophic outcomes in the United States National Practitioner Database in this slide, broken down by specialty. I have found out that all of the malpractice claims are reported to this so-called it's called the physicians call it a blacklist. It's called by risk managers the information pile. It's called by some policymakers as the marble chamber. Basically, it's a database. It's got a registry where every single malpractice claim in the United States is registered anytime there's an exchange of money. So we're not talking about frivolous claims where there's no payout. And we're not talking about people that are simply angry and threaten a lawsuit. We're talking about an exchange of money. Or if there's a court verdict, then it's registered in the National Practitioner Data Bank. Or if there's an official action by a state medical board or a national professional medical society. So basically, all of those things go into this National Practitioner Data Bank. And here's the breakdown. Neurosurgery is high at the list, cardiothoracic surgery, general surgery, orthopedic. Basically, the surgical subspecialties top the list. Now, if we look at, on a more granular level, the issue of never events, wrong site surgery, wrong patient surgery, wrong procedure surgery, and one that is not really easily captured in the National Practitioner Data Bank, that is death in an ASA Class 1 patient. It turns out that there are about 40 of these events every week in the United States. Now, the average malpractice settlement in the United States, using the figures in the National Practitioner Data Bank, which actually we found out when we published this article, it's the only estimate that we have out there because there's no other data bank that keeps track of every exchange of money related to a claim. Now, this does not include an entire institution being sued or one institution suing another institution. These are lawsuits or claims against physicians, and the average payout is $224,000. turns out most doctors will have a claim at some point in their careers if they're a busy physician. And over the course of their career, they will have seen enough patients to have, on average, one claim. Well, it turns out that in my experience talking to doctors about the subject of safety, it's this potential event which connects closely with doctors. And when you start talking about, here's what happened in one claim, here's how a case was dropped, here are the grounds where there was a payout in this situation, there's a sort of hyper-acute sense of relevance to their everyday lives. This is a good way, I think, to bring patient safety home. You know, for example, the question of what age are physicians most likely to have a malpractice claim? I thought it was the youngest doctors or maybe the oldest doctors. Well, it turns out here that the age bracket 40 to 49 actually are the group with the highest number of surgical never events, and this holds true also for claims in general in the National Practitioner Data Bank. Now, it's almost as if those that come straight out of training are hyper aware of what they're doing, overly cautious or taking added precautions or using senior backup or relying on support staff as their safety net more. And it's almost as if those that are significantly older than that group, those in their 60s and 70s, have some type of wisdom or experience that allows them to practice in a safer fashion. It's almost as if they've incorporated the wisdom of prior generations or prior experiences in their day-to-day practice. Well, here's the article and story that aired on NPR 3 weeks ago. How many people die from medical mistakes in the United States each year? Well, it turns out the number of 210,000, which they identify from analyzing several studies, puts the problem of medical mistakes as the number three cause of death in the United States. If we look at heart disease, or some people generally group number one and four and call it cardiovascular disease, if we put both those categories together or separate, it won't change the ranking of the 210,000 deaths a year that would fall in between cancer and chronic lower respiratory diseases, which includes pneumonia. Now, we spend a lot of time and money on heart disease. We spend a lot of time and money on cancer. If you saw the 60 Minutes last Sunday night, there's always excitement when we get a little closer to cracking the code on cancer. But we have a number three cause of death in the United States that is not even recognized by many people out there. So we can't really start talking about this as a problem unless we're serious about recognizing it in its rank in the United States and the way it creates harm. Now, if we step back from the entire healthcare system, it is remarkable that we have unintended consequences of great things that we do. For example, we have, in modern day society, we have these wonderful things called medications. We love to use them, we prescribe them, they cure people of their diseases, they can make someone's life stronger, healthier. They can cure diseases that were otherwise incurable, like childhood lymphomas and leukemias. Medicines have done a tremendous good in society, but if we step back and look at the trade-off, that is the unintended consequences of medications in society, we have actually ushered in the unintended consequence of prescription drug abuse, which just now, maybe 50 to 100 years after adoption in society, is it being recognized by the CDC and the FDA to be a serious public health endemic. In one recent report, and you've seen many of these studies on prescription drugs, 5% of the entire United States population may be addicted to prescription medications. Now, I'm not suggesting we get rid of medications. I'm just saying, let's take a step back of our entire system of delivering care and ask ourselves, what unintended consequence have we ushered in? Now, if you take a step back from the entire healthcare system or the concept of hospitalizing somebody to take care of them, in this New England Journal report, there have been really no differences in the rates of preventable harm over the last several years, and the rates may be as high as 1 in 4 hospitalized patients being harmed in some way. Now, you can have someone get a slightly higher dose of subcutaneous heparin. It's not going to kill them, but it is remarkable to think of the hazards which continue to this day. Now, in the era of King George, there was an effort to unite two societies of the day, the Society of Barber Surgeons and the Society of Physicians. And these two groups came together, and the idea was to create a more united medical front to work on disease and to present a more coherent set of recommendations to patients. Now, it's remarkable what doctors used to do. And when I think of our own roots in surgery as being barbers, it's kind of frightening. But there was civility at the time, and there was tremendous respect. If you think about what we have today, and I would allude to the Archives of Surgery article by Forte and Klein. And in this article, they basically describe anonymity as a precursor of disruptive behavior. If you think about the way we drive, you're more likely, even if you're a nice person, to engage in disruptive behavior if you have no idea who is driving on the road with you. But the second that someone identifies who's in the other car, hey, that's my daughter's school teacher, that's my little league, that's my son's little league coach, then instantly there's a sense of shame or embarrassment or applying dignity in a formal apology, which may be due. So that is an example of where we see anonymity promote disruptive behavior in everyday life. Now, take that into the operating theater, especially at a large academic medical center like the one I work in. We've got students and residents and nurse anesthetists and observers and all kinds of people in and out of the room all the time. It can be hard to remember that creating a culture of civility where there's good teamwork is an important priority. Here's a study where we just asked people, do you know the names of the people you worked with on your last shift, either in the operating room or on the surgical ward? And we found that the nurses knew the most names, followed by the support staff, the anesthesia providers, the residents, and then next to last was anesthesia attendings, and then the absolute worst performing individual was the surgeon. Now, this came as a little bit of a wake-up call to me and a little bit of a shock, but the data speak for themselves. This was a study performed in 60 U.S. hospitals. Brian Sexton and several others were involved in this study about 7 years ago. And as the surgeon in this study group, I was almost a little offended by the data, but the data speak for themselves. We're supposed to be the captain of the ship, but oftentimes we don't know who's on the ship. And it turns out that this all just promotes anonymity. And anonymity, therefore, promotes disruptive behavior, or at least is a precursor. Now, in the operating room, many times we're masked. So if there's any environment where we have to make the effort to get to know the names through a briefing or some kind of conversation, it's in the operating room. When we looked at the implementation of what we like to call briefings or what's become popularized as a checklist, the number of folks that feel more comfortable speaking up if they perceive a problem increased. That is, the difficulty in speaking up decreased when there was a time to do some kind of team discussion. Now, many of you are involved in quality and safety efforts at your hospital, and you may lead them. When you attend a meeting and you have to speak up at the beginning of a meeting, be it in a brief message or a formal presentation, you're activated. You feel that you are an official participant in the meeting. Even if you have to say, on behalf of Dr. Bob, he wanted me to pass on a message that he's going to be running 5 minutes late. Well, just speaking up in any form in a meeting almost makes it easier to speak up later about an unrelated subject, because you've become an official participant the first time that you speak in a group. And that's the idea of a briefing. We've got to promote these discussions before procedures, before we take care of patients. It can be any civil discussion, and it creates that sense of participation and decreases anonymity. And that has a tremendous effect. If there's one serious problem that still gets in the way of patient safety in many of the hospitals that I visit, it's this problem of folks that just are not on the team. You know, many times when I travel, I'll have doctors and nurses tell me, you know, we know how to make care safer or quality better at this hospital. But the problem is we just don't feel that we can really control it. We feel that there's one disruptive person, or we feel that we're just in charge of this one slice of the entire patient experience. If we could help design the entire delivery of care, we could really, we know what it would take to make it a lot better. Well, one exciting thing in the future of patient safety that I'd like to mention is this subject of triggers. Now, if we've made modest progress, if any, over the last several years in patient safety, and I think we've seen some pockets of medicine where we've seen tremendous progress in patient safety, and others where we really haven't seen much. I think of my own field of doing pancreas surgery. You know, we've made some scientific progress, but not much in the way we take care of patients. We've made some progress in the quality of healthcare services that are provided as a field, but we haven't made tremendous progress. If anything, the biggest progress in my own field of surgery sometimes I think is the culture. I think that behaviors that used to be tolerated in the operating room are no longer tolerated today. And students that would maybe be quiet or even chuckle when they saw disruptive behavior 5 or 10 years ago will now be disgusted by it sometimes. Now that's a significant advancement in getting towards a more civil workplace environment. Now in the field of triggers, there's some exciting stuff going on right now. This is an article that is actually a part of a series of articles by David Klassen that look at the impact of triggers on healthcare. Now it turns out if you think about coming out of surgery or being in any clinical environment in the hospital, and a patient is having trouble breathing, and the urine output is a little low, and they've got a little bit of pain somewhere. Picture someone coming out of surgery, and they just don't look right. They don't look like the typical patient coming out of a prostate operation. Well, it turns out that if you order a chest x-ray, and you page someone for a stat consult, or do any one of these combination of global triggers, then a smart hospital system, that is through their IT, extracting this information from what's going on the front lines, can actually tell you that something bad is about to happen. There's a high-risk zone at the hospital, and there's a potential for a major patient catastrophe. So if you look at any two of these events, and certainly three would make it an even further outlier of risk, an overnight stay of an ambulatory patient, for example. If you look at someone who stays overnight, even though they were planning to go home the same day of surgery, that means there potentially could be something going on wrong here. If you look back after disasters have taken place and you say, here's someone who after a simple appendectomy died 3 days after surgery. Well, it turns out there were probably these triggers that manifested immediately after the surgery. They could be minor, and each individually could be considered almost negligible. But in combination, it means that something is brewing. So hospital systems now are saying, how can we look at these global triggers, or basically risk factors for patient safety events, in real time? Can we extract these things from the IT systems at a hospital? For example, if you're ordering an x-ray, the computer systems know that there's an order for an x-ray. If you're ordering a consult for a pulmonologist, the computer systems can actually extract that. And there's talk about hospitals being able to send teams in real time to go and prevent major adverse events in the same way that we have rapid response teams that rely on someone to activate them. You know, if we look at the broader picture in healthcare for a moment, if we step back, we have generally a reactive culture in medicine. That is, we tend to implement policies to make things safer or deliver higher quality care after we've had a bad experience or in response to a regulatory requirement, which we know, of course, regulations can never work as effectively as the local wisdom of people on the front lines of medicine. So if we take a step back and ask ourselves, what can we do differently? Things like the global trigger tool or identification of high-risk events before they happen may be one future direction. You know, when I was in an airport recently about to go through the TSA line, someone came out from the TSA. They had noticed someone going through the metal detector with their shoes on, and it set off the metal detector, and they told the person to go back and take their shoes off and put it on the belt. Obviously, it must have been an inexperienced traveler or maybe somebody that was in a rush. Well, then the TSA agent came out to the line where we were all waiting to go through the security checkpoint and yelled at all of us. Now, we don't even know who this guy was, but there was this reaction, this sort of reactive nature of getting people to be compliant. And essentially, we do the same thing in healthcare. We've got M&M conferences that identify things we just did wrong and what can we do to prevent this from happening. We tell everyone else, make sure you do it this way or that way. And that's important. It's an important part of the quality improvement endeavor. But what about sitting down in a group and saying, hey, how are we going to harm the next patient? And that question is fundamentally the question which spawned this idea of a cusp effort or a cusp group. When we sat down and we asked ourselves, how can we get people to think more proactively about patient safety? We thought maybe that's the question to put in front of the group. And that question really is the number one question that drives cusp groups. Now, you can call them anything you want. When my research partner, Peter Pronovost, came up with the term cusp, we thought, you know, who cares what you call it? The idea is to get people on the front lines of medicine together to talk about safety proactively. What are your ideas? Can we sit down and ask those in all levels of the hierarchy of the operating room, hey, how are we going to harm the next patient? What are the incompatible equipment issues that we've been dealing with? And it turns out there's a lot of wisdom on the front lines. Groups have been doing cusp for decades, maybe even longer. Even before we threw out there the idea of a cusp group, groups have been getting together to talk about safety. Hospitals have been organizing. They've been taking on safety with new positions in senior management to say, hey, how can we be more proactive? You know, the problem of being reactive is not our problem. It's a problem in medicine altogether. It's actually a problem in society. If you look at a lot of the problems, be it the way we just managed our fiscal issues on Capitol Hill. It's a broader problem. If you think about the American Medical Association recently declaring that obesity is a disease, I think it depicts exactly this sort of reactive nature of the way we tend to approach large endemics in healthcare. I don't know about at your hospital, but we've had obesity for a long time. And it's something, for example, that we could have been a lot more proactive in thinking about 20, 30 years ago, back when we started talking about the role of sugar and other things. Now, I was recently traveling, and I visited a small hotel in a city called Baku, Azerbaijan. This is a city that sits beautifully between Europe and Asia. And this city is a wonderful city. It's on the Caspian Sea. It has a beautiful mix of Russian and Persian cultures, Asian and European cultures. And it's got tremendous history. It's got a wonderful heritage, tremendous architecture. And I was there for the Eurasian Surgical Congress. And I remember the hotel was so nice. I spoke with someone in the hotel who worked there about the hotel. I complimented them on the hotel. I like talking to random people, as some of you may know. And I told them, I said, you know, this hotel was so wonderful. I would actually think about coming here just for a vacation. And they were really impressed. And they said, well, you know, this is all new. It wasn't this nice for a long time. And I said, what do you mean? And I asked a little further, and they said, well, you know, this hotel for a long time, for decades, was a mess. It was a bad hotel to go to. And I said, what do you mean? The rooms were dirty. The bathrooms were kind of disgusting. The service was poor. The food wasn't great. Your reservations didn't even have a high degree of fidelity. Well, I said, well, what about this hotel across the street? And they said, same thing. And it turns out there are four hotels in that little district. And they said that all four hotels were equally terrible. So I couldn't help but ask the question, what happened? And they explained that what happened was TripAdvisor. TripAdvisor came to town. And all of a sudden, every guest who stayed there had the opportunity to rate their experience. And TripAdvisor, for the first time, created transparency around many of the service and quality problems at the different hotels. I thought that was a remarkable example of how transparency can revolutionize an industry. As a matter of fact, I did a little research on TripAdvisor, and it turns out that 62% of hotels on TripAdvisor will increase their rating from a 2 to 3 to greater than 3, which is considered to be a good rating, within 1 year of being listed on TripAdvisor. You know, it reminds me of what Toby Cosgrove told a group of us at the Cleveland Clinic. He said that he's now having publicly available patient satisfaction scores, and every year in which the satisfaction scores are public, the scores increase. And when asked why the scores go up every year, are people kinder to the doctors in rating them? And his response was interesting. He said, you know, doctors are the most competitive creatures on the face of the planet. And you put a goal in front of a doctor and they will outperform every time. They are metrics driven. So I decided to get on the TripAdvisor website, and I looked at some reviews, and I thought this review was interesting. It's titled Not Good. It says, too bad there wasn't a ranking worse than terrible. If you plan to stay here, don't expect to sleep. And it goes on and on about all the problems at the hotel. Well, it turns out the manager wrote a response to this complaint, apologizing, explaining, offering his personal email and phone number. I mean, I think this person is going to get a nice upgrade if they ever go back to that hotel. This is a management that responds to problems. And it turns out that in any industry, when you see this level of publicly available satisfaction ratings, not only does quality go up, but revenue goes up. There's a recent article in the Harvard Business Review last month. If you can pick up the September 2013 Harvard Business Review on page 95, you'll see a graph that is listing patients or average satisfaction. Obviously, they're not patients. Just satisfaction scores for companies, both in the television, in the pay television world, and in the auto insurance world, and revenue growth. And it's directly correlated. It's very impressive. Not only if the businesses thrive using patient satisfaction or satisfaction scores, rather, but they've also increased their revenue. Well, how about healthcare? What are the implications for what we do? What are the implications for me as a general surgeon when I do an appendectomy procedure? Can transparency improve quality in ways that would represent a giant leapfrog advance? Well, in the New England Journal of Medicine this week, John Berkmeyer and colleagues at the University of Michigan published an article showing that video records of a surgeon's skill blindly and independently rated directly correlate with patient outcomes following a standard index complex surgical procedure. And it turns out that there are tremendous implications throughout healthcare of just measuring what we do. Now, in my field, video makes sense, but in many fields, it's just some form of feedback in the metrics. Take, for example, colonoscopy. Doug Rex is one of the most well-known GI endoscopic physicians in the country. He put colon cancer screening on the map. He essentially created the standards for doing colonoscopy, but he's been very much bothered by the wide variation in quality in his own field. So he did this study, which I think is remarkable, a study I could never get approved by my IRB. He basically recorded the colonoscopy procedures to see if they were high quality and to see whether or not doctors were spending the 6 minutes they were supposed to spend looking for polyps and lesions. You see, that's an industry standard. When the colonoscopy goes in, the scope goes to the cecum, and on the drawback, many of you are physicians, you may be familiar with this, on the pullback, you're supposed to spend 6 minutes looking for polyps and lesions. That's what we teach the residents. That's the standard. That's the Medicare payment requirement. Well, what Dr. Rex found in watching videos of the procedure, over 100 videos, is that the quality was all over the map, and this was at a good center. He noticed that some doctors were spending 1.5 or 2 minutes looking for polyps. Others were spending 10 minutes. Others had high-quality scores, and others had low-quality scores. These were blindly and independently ranked. And then Dr. Rex did something radical, but yet very basic in the spirit of transparency and accountability. He announced to all the doctors in the group, "I'm going to be watching your colonoscopy videos." Nothing punitive, no fines, no government regulators stepping in, just a respected peer offering feedback on something that's measurable. And it turns out that the quality after colonoscopy improved after the announcement by 31%, and the time spent, the mean inspection time increased by 50%. And he published these results. Remarkable example of the power of transparency to increase accountability and drive major advances in quality improvement. Major advances. We're talking about a near elimination of the greatest problem in American Western medicine, and that problem is variation. I think about my own field when we're doing a laparoscopic distal pancreatectomy. This is a picture from an operation I did yesterday. We're dissecting the hepatic artery. You know, I would love it if somebody could review a video just like a football player could learn from their performance at a football game. Even if we did it once a month, I would love the feedback of another doctor, a laparoscopic expert, or even a surgeon with pancreas experience. There's a tremendous amount that we can learn if we harness the power of all of the information technology systems that we now have. This would have been impossible 10 years ago. Can you imagine 20 years ago when we had to ask, is the video on VHS or beta? I mean, we now have data storage and transfer capacity that would really allow us to move the needle on quality and safety using some of the new information that we're learning about its effectiveness. There was a program at the Brigham and Women's Hospital where they had surgeons coached, and in a wonderful study, Caprice Greenberg and others wrote up their experience asking the doctors, what did you think of the experience? And they all said, every surgeon said that they liked the coaching program, that they benefited in some way. It might have been a suggestion on how to better expose tissue or safety techniques or a new instrument or device that was suggested to them. There's a lot we can learn from increased transparency. Here's the study by Berkmeyer that just appeared in the New England Journal of Medicine. Great study. Essentially, it shows what many people have long suspected, and that is that quality in medicine is measurable and it correlates with outcome, the quality of the care provided. It holds true when you drive down the street. If you think about all the efforts to educate people about following the speed limit, they have been not very successful. For decades, we've been telling people to follow the speed limit, and it hasn't really worked very well. But one thing radically eliminated variation in how fast people drive through an intersection, and that is a prominent speed camera that provides some feedback, although punitive, for the driver. And in medicine, how many things have we been beating on for decades, saying as the last bullet point in a PowerPoint presentation, education. We need to educate more, educate folks about the importance of teamwork or the role of non-technical skills or the importance of hand washing. When Long Island North Shore Hospital put cameras at their hand washing sinks to monitor hand washing compliance, they went from a compliance rate of less than 50% to over 90% overnight. In other words, transparency essentially eliminated the problem of wide variation. If you look at the Institute of Medicine report that came out last year, in my opinion, more significant than the 1999 report, the recent report indicates that up to one-third of everything we spend money on in healthcare may be unnecessary, going to fraud or overtreatment, unnecessary tests, defensive medicine, or things that really don't make patients any better. Well, if there's one problem in American medicine today that we all recognize, it's the problem of variation. So there's, I think, a lot of exciting things going on in this field right now, and I know we have a time to discuss them as a group. And in my own field of surgery, we see laparoscopic and open surgery done like the Wild West. You could have the same operation done through a big incision or a small incision. One has a 15% rate of an incisional hernia. The other has a 1% rate. One has a 12% rate of a wound infection, the other has a 1% rate of a wound infection. One has more pain, one has less pain. Radically different ways to do the same operation, but yet it's the Wild West. When I talk to patients, hey, why'd you choose to come to this hospital? They'll say things like, no, the parking here was good. We have a healthcare system that is competing, but it's competing over the wrong things. We need to have competition over performance and value rather than competition over billboards and marketing. We need to have competition over quality in a way that's transparent and provides accountability in a way that's not punitive, but formative, rather than competition over things like parking. So those are my thoughts today. I want to thank everybody for listening and make myself available at any time to talk about these issues further. I learned so much from other folks telling me about their experiences at their own hospitals. So I think the more we can acknowledge that none of us have the code here to make hospitals perfect, but we're all learning together in a community where we can be honest about our mistakes, I think the better for the field. So in that spirit, I want to thank Dr. Denham for hosting this and for the rest of the panel for being a part of this.
Well, thank you, Dr. Makary. This is Frank Hughes. I'm going to jump in. I believe Chuck had to step out for a little bit. He'll be joining back on in the Q&A. I'd like to point out to the audience that there is a Q&A box in the lower right-hand corner. So as they have listened to this very engaging and thought-provoking presentation, if you all have any questions for Dr. Makary, please feel free to submit. Also, we'll be
Frank, I'll just jump in.
I'm glad I wasn't sure that you were there.
Marty, that was terrific. And so Frank is our CTO. I'm going to have him carry it forth here on this Sharps issue after he covers a couple of loose ends, but terrific focus on transparency, Marty. Go ahead, Frank.
Okay, I was just going to also have you point out we've started a series of questions, poll questions, that the audience, we're inviting you to respond, that touch on the topic which we'll be addressing shortly around Sharps as well as healthcare infections. With that, I actually, while we wait, I'm going to transition. Just a couple of questions for Dr. Makary regarding transparency and maybe addressing some of the challenges and overcoming the pushback that you hear around the lack of information or lack of data, or the concerns that someone's going to cherry pick a data point and turn it into a soundbite that's going to play on the 8 o'clock news. How do you overcome that in terms of, you know, guiding the leadership through that thought process?
Well, I think it's a great question, and one where we can turn to our professional physician and nurse associations to say, hey, what do you think is important? What do you think is an important way to measure quality? You know, I bet a respiratory therapist knows more about measuring quality than a doc in the ICU. I bet you when it comes to ventilation management, they may have as many good ideas as our team does at Hopkins, which is, you know, has many good critical care doctors on it. You know, there's a lot that we can learn from the front lines of medicine. With the American College of Surgeons, thanks to the leadership of many folks that I think are very forward-minded in quality and safety, we've been able to put together metrics of performance that are fair and risk-adjusted. Because I think doctors are good to be afraid of metrics that don't appropriately account for risk. I worry in my own practice, are we going to reward doctors that discriminate against high-risk patients and punish those that take them on? So they've developed sophisticated formulas, and I think we can say to the frontline societies, hey, what do you think is important?
Great. Well, you know what? We're going to transition over with Linda Groh on a topic I know that you've worked on it pretty extensively, and obviously love to hear your feedback and comment. And I'm just going to go through four slides that were presented in our last webinars regarding sharp injuries, and really something that has been brought to our attention, and Linda Groh with AORN, the Association of Perioperative Registered Nurses, obviously has been very much focused on that, which is this, while we've been quite successful in reducing the number of sharps injury in the typical environment, we are seeing an increase in the OR and trying to understand how we can have an impact on that. So this is one area where after the Needle Safety and Prevention Act we had increased awareness and a kind of a systems approach to addressing this. However, we still seem to have some challenges in the space of the OR. And obviously, it is a high-risk environment with objects that are considerably sharper, and the risk is greater because of the stress levels. And but one of the things that we noticed that was clearly interesting, and this ties back to some of the discussions that we were having earlier regarding leadership and captain of the ship, which is the nature of the injuries and the proportions of these injuries, whereby some of the team members are obviously injured while they're using, and typically these are going to be the surgeons, while there's another group that more frequently, the surgical team, gets injured as a result of passing the Sharps instruments. And having an increased awareness in that space apparently is something that obviously needs to be brought to the attention not only of the team, but probably also, as it seems, to the groups that are involved in regulatory aspects of this. So we understand that this is a major problem or an emerging problem that we need to shine a light on. And with that, I'd like to have kind of Linda maybe react, and I posted a few of these slides here. And maybe, Linda, if you wouldn't mind kind of giving us some of the context that you're seeing on the front line with your nurses, and obviously some of the areas of where we could see some solutions or some areas of improvement.
Absolutely. Thank you, Frank. I want to first of all point out that we identified on the slide that there are over 384,000 percutaneous injuries that occur in the hospitals in the United States. When you add the non-hospital healthcare workers, it's over 500,000. And to pick up on what Marty said, you know, the data speaks for itself. This is an issue, and it's not only the healthcare worker injury, but also if the healthcare worker is infected, either known or unknown, with bloodborne pathogens, they can then really reconnect with the patient and infect the patient. So the patient becomes at risk for an infection also. So it's not only the healthcare workers we need to be concerned about, but the patients that end up being injured as a part of these percutaneous injuries. One of the most important things that we have found is that the surgeons have a great deal of discretion over the selection of devices, and their awareness of the link between their device choice and the safety of the operative team and the patient appears to be generally very low. And again, getting to what Marty talked about with transparency and with the appropriateness of being accountable for the care that we deliver, this is another point that just needs to be drilled on. And we are taking up this cause. We believe it is absolutely an issue that needs to be addressed. And it really needs to be addressed by leadership at the institution. Safety has to be woven into the very fabric of the facility. It has to be part of the culture. And the person who can best lead the charge is the CEO. They can drive this issue at the top, and it should be in everybody's strategic plan, not just on Sharps injuries, but on all of the injuries that the safety culture and the injuries that are occurring to our patients. When they come to the hospital and they are coming there for care and they leave with an injury of any kind, we need to be very, very cautious about that, and we need to put into place plans of action that will prevent that from happening. I think the other thing is that there is less promotion of safety engineered devices for cutting and suturing for the types of needles that can be used in the surgical environment as opposed to outside. There's been a lot of emphasis on the injectable needles, but not as much on the suture needles, and that is a big cause for the injury to many of the surgeons and residents. And then finally, I think the third factor is the enforcement and compliance of the Needle Safety Prevention Act in the OR is relatively low. Both OSHA and Joint Commission have a tendency to look outside the operating room as opposed to inside the operating room to see what measures are being taken to prevent injury. And I think all of these things together would make a difference and would really change what we're looking at in terms of the number of sharps injuries that occur in the operating room. And it is true, it is increasing, whereas everywhere else in the hospital there has been a decrease in the number of sharps injuries. Back to you, Frank.
Well, I'll ask, and I know that Dr. Makary, you've published pretty extensively on that topic, and in terms of questions related to that, in terms of awareness and the role of the surgeon and the surgical team, some of the best practices you might have seen and would like to comment on?
Sure, yeah. We did a study asking doctors and residents, do you report a needle stick injury when you get stuck by a needle? And we found out that the vast majority of these reports of these events are never reported. And not only that, we found that 99% of our surgical trainees are stuck by a needle at some point during their training. So one, it's a big problem, but two, if they don't report it, it speaks to the problem of the culture where there's not a good culture of speaking up. And it's tragic because with the infections and modern day treatments, it's very hard to get an infection from a needle stick injury if you get help right away. It's the prophylaxis really with HIV makes it a super rare, almost a reportable event if anyone ever contracts HIV from a needle stick with the appropriate prophylaxis started within 24 hours. And even with Hep C, early treatment can prevent the conversion to chronicity in over 80% of the cases. So it's important, I think, that folks know it's okay to be stuck by a needle. Most people get stuck by needles at some point, and it's a problem that you should report, and we can talk about. It's not a sign of bad technique or a failure. It's a sign that we need to create a safer system.
Right.
Frank, may I ask a quick question? Marty, we're seeing just to shift gears just for a moment, to surgery and the outpatient surgery and the procedural suites, we're seeing a silent epidemic of multiple infections that are not being reported, and that, in fact, CDC, sometimes the first notification you have as a patient is CDC contacts you because the hospitals are not being transparent about when they have a problem in a procedure suite. And we also know that a study of the outpatient surgery facilities a few years ago in three states showed that there's a significant problem with infections. Anything you can recommend to us, as many of our safety officers are now having to be responsible for these suites because their practices and programs are being acquired by bigger hospital systems, and our safety officers are, sometimes they don't even know where these facilities are.
Chuck, this is Linda. I can respond that I think one of the issues there is that there seems to be a different set of standards that exist in these freestanding areas and areas that have not been accustomed to using a set of standards and recommended practices that are evidence-based. And I think that's one of the things that's contributing to this, and it definitely is becoming an issue.
Just to add one question. Go ahead, Marty.
A couple of years ago, we asked the question, do we really need to be using all the sharps that we use in the operating room? I had a patient once that had both hepatitis C and HIV, and we asked ourselves, can we make the incision with the cutting current on the electrical cautery in this patient to avoid passing a sharp and bloody knife around the operative theater? Can we close the skin with glue instead of subcuticular 4-0 vicryl stitches? Sometimes there are alternative techniques that have the same clinical benefit in the right candidate situations and can minimize the risk. And we published this as an article titled Sharpless Surgery. And I think there's a lot of stuff out there we can think about.
Great. Frank, did you have another question you wanted to ask?
I was going to ask, in terms of the role of the surgeons, obviously, we talked about the comprehensive surgical checklist and the opportunity there maybe to raise the awareness about how we're going to manage some of these sharps around the theater, and specifically some simple, and this is more kind of a question, you know, you mentioned the sharp list. That's obviously a technological solution, but are there workflow or systems approach that could greatly impact the risk for the team, not only for the surgeon, but also for the team that's working with the surgeon?
Well, there are some things that can be done that are very simple, like double gloving. That is something that is well accepted. The American College of Surgeons has supported double gloving. A hands-free technique, again, we're not at that in implementing a hands-free technique. You're not using anything different. There's no difference in terms of how the techniques or the workflow changes. So there are some things that can be done without interrupting the workflow in the operating room. And I think Marty talked about the briefing. The briefing is a great place to set the stage for what's going to happen during that surgical procedure, and everybody to agree that these items are going to be used. And also, that briefing also means that people have the opportunity then to really get to know each other and know first names and be able to respond when they see something happening that is not with the plan of care that's been developed. For instance, using the sharps technique.
Marty, do you have comments?
Only that, to add to what Linda said, debriefing is also a great time to report injuries. We've included from time to time the question in the debriefing, has anyone sustained an exposure to bloodborne pathogen? And if the answer is yes, then we just try to create a safe place for them to say, you should go down to occupational health and here's where it's located or here's the number.
And that definitely should be available 24/7 in all facilities.
Marty, what do you think the next wave of transparency and innovation, or innovation and transparency, we will see? Are you seeing people responding to your message in your book and your message in speaking?
Yeah, I've actually been really surprised by the positive response from the book. Even though the publisher put what I thought was a pretty inflammatory title on it, at least it wasn't called 50 Shades of Healthcare, which I think was one of the ideas they threw out there. But I wanted to tell the story of doctors and nurses on the front lines of medicine to say, hey, they are passionate about quality. They get very upset when they see a preventable harm. And here are some homegrown solutions from the front lines of medicine on how to make care better. And I talk about some of the transparency programs at the Cleveland Clinic, some of the patient-centered care emphasis, some of the new work on the national societies to develop mature metrics of hospital performance. I think all of us are appropriately afraid of bad raw metrics being put out there to unfairly evaluate healthcare. We're just going to create an uneven playing field if the metrics are immature. But the mature metrics are very powerful, extremely powerful. When you talk to cardiologists, they all agree that once they refined the door-to-balloon time metric, it improved quality across the board. We're seeing it now with other fields where patient satisfaction is important and other things. So, maybe it's C-section rates if you're an obstetrician. But we're seeing a new wave of metrics mature. And in the book Unaccountable, I basically tried to describe almost as an observer what's going on. And I think that 5 years ago, the book Unaccountable would have been radical. But now this stuff is actually happening.
Well, it's commendable that you wrote it, and it did cause. I think the title did get people to really want to see what story that you had to tell. One quick question on a potential NTSP for healthcare, looking at the concept of applying what we've learned in aviation about the multi-causal factors of accidents, especially when we look at health IT and other areas where we are seeing now new accidents that are occurring that we're learning about. on Saturday, we had a workshop at the ASA, at the American Society of Anesthesia, where we had the debate on an NPSB, and we certainly didn't hear any major arguments of why not. It was just a matter of funding. And we had the same dialogue with the American Board of Radiology Foundation meeting, which both also said this is a good idea. What's your thought of being able to have a national approach, not whether we should fund another government agency, but just use these methods of looking at very common systematic failures that we could all learn from?
You know, it's a great point, Chuck. When someone dies from an aviation accident, the black box is retrieved and the entire pilot community in the United States learns something from that accident. And yet in healthcare, the same mistakes happen again and again. And sometimes we don't need sophisticated investigations. Sometimes we do, but other times you can talk to a nurse that was in the room and they say, yeah, I've seen this before. I could have told you something was going to happen. A lot of people are saying, and I've talked to Peter Pronovost about this a fair bit. He's sort of the one that put it out there first, but we've talked about what about having a security and exchange commission for healthcare? What about the metrics of performance? When you submit your infection rates, you could have a very sloppy way of capturing your infections, in which case you'll look good, or you could have a very intense and robust way of capturing infections, in which case your hospital will look worse. So we should probably have some standardized methods of reporting, just like in any other industry where there's transparency. You take businesses, for example, Sarbanes-Oxley keeps businesses accountable, and the CEO is accountable for their earnings reports. If they misreport their earnings, a CEO can go to jail. Now, we're not suggesting anyone go to jail in healthcare, but there's some accountability in business for the numbers you put out there. And the same should be true for these widely agreed upon quality metrics that are being put out.
Fantastic answer. Linda, what, the two questions that we think are probably two of the most powerful questions that we've ever had going out on the floor with nurses is, number one, what was your last near miss? And the second question is, what do you think our next accident will be? What will be our next bad event? And it is so enlightening, although it is a subjective sort of approach and not a rigorous randomized prospective trial. Your thoughts on that, on how much the nurses really know about these system issues?
That's a really good question, Chuck, and I think if you ask any nurse that you're going to ask, you're going to get a response, because they do know what the issues are. They do know what they, and they have ideas on what, how to prevent those things from happening. And high reliability organizations ask those kinds of questions. They're not preoccupied with what's happening today, but what could happen and what can we do to prevent. So making administrative rounds is a great way to use those two questions to ask the staff nurses, whether it's in the operating room or on the nursing units, because they do know where the issues are. But it's up to leadership then to act on the findings and to take action to prevent those things from occurring or to correct what the issues are.
Linda, do you think there's an opportunity for a future time when we could have a webinar and put the best teams that are have the best team play of physicians, nurses, operating room technologists, anesthesiologists, surgeons, and have them tell their stories? Do you think that that would be of value to the nursing community? I think it would be for the physician community, but Marty, you can react to that. But Linda first.
Absolutely. I think, you know, there are pockets of excellence in this country. There are people who have figured out how to do this and do it well. And we need to learn from those facilities and those teams, because they are operating at the high reliability end of the spectrum.
Marty, thoughts on that kind of a cross-functional team sort of approach, and maybe a webinar or two when we can talk about the team play and our audience can kind of hear how the best teams are operating?
I like the idea a lot, Chuck. You know, when I go down to the medical school lobby, there are sometimes students interviewing for medical school there. They're college students or a few years out of college. And they're wearing new suits, and they look good, and they're smiling, they're nervous. These are talented, creative people that go into healthcare. We've got good people that go in. but they come out 10 years later, beat down, wearing sneakers and pajamas and burnout, and they're different people. I mean, they look like different people. And I think sometimes not only can we look at successes, but we can ask ourselves, how are we creating a culture that changes people and moves them towards the wrong type of person that we want in healthcare? What are the subtle ways in which we teach people through modeling behaviors that can be very dangerous?
That's fantastic thoughts. We really think there's a huge opportunity for leadership development and to focus on kind of the anatomy and physiology of how we build great leaders through our young faculty and our medical students. Marty, we're coming close to the end of our discussion. We've got six more minutes. Are there some bright lights, shining lights of innovators out there in the space that where you're operating that we could be aware of? It's always easy to talk about what we're not doing, what we're not doing right. But we learn so much from the bright lights of those that are doing it right. Can you give us some organizations out there that you visited where you see some great innovation and really leadership and transparency?
Well, it's interesting because some of the places that I've been to and visited and really been impressed are not always the big hospitals. And yes, I've been to Mayo Clinic and Cleveland Clinic and some of these other great medical centers and been very impressed with the dedication and the number of people devoted and the resources spent on patient safety. But I remember recently going to Northern Mississippi Medical Center, which, as you may know, won the Baldrige Award. And you talk about an amazing company workplace culture. Everybody there is devoted to the mission of making sure the patients get good care. And, you know, I think of the story once where a doctor describes getting a post-it note on their computer that said, patient called and said that they're bleeding. And they got the note on Monday morning. Well, that's not a post-it note, that's a phone call. But if everything is just by protocol and everyone is just doing their job, you lack the sense of passion about the mission to provide good care, and people don't take it on themselves to navigate the system on behalf of patients and be their advocates and look at the entire delivery of care.
So, as you look at these great organizations, and I know some of the unanswered questions that we have, and we'll ask you a couple of questions from the audience, and if you have a question, we'll try to grab it here at the end. But Marty, as we look at at the challenges people have working with their surgeons, what advice do you have to the folks in this audience that are safety or quality officers or work in the operating room on what's the best approach to our surgeons to help us with patient safety and engage them? Advice there, with your club.
Well, you know, surgeons are a unique group, if I can say that about ourselves. We sometimes have this mantra. It's not a good mantra, but we have this mantra that we can only learn from ourselves. And because of that history, peer-based talk about safety, the discussions that come from other surgeons about new initiatives and collaboratives, we're doing one on surgical cusp, we're doing one on readmission. We're trying to engage surgeons at the national meetings and talk to them about safety and urinary tract prevention, infection prevention. So I think that surgeons respond a lot to data. Physicians in general, all of us in healthcare, we're taught data, and that's what defines what we do and don't do. And when there's data behind safety, as we're now seeing, I think it really connects with folks that are in this field. Of course, we have to remember that data doesn't just come from randomized controlled trials. It also comes from local wisdom. If you look at a recent response letter by Eric Topral following a study in the New England Journal of Medicine, he says that if you look at the last 10 years of randomized controlled trials in the New England Journal of Medicine, 49% have had the conclusions reversed or undone by subsequent findings or research. 49%. So randomized controlled trials are not the end-all game that we talk about. Sure, it's important, and maybe it's most applicable to placebo-based medication trials. But in patient safety, there's a lot of wisdom that already lives in medicine. And sometimes we just need to be open to it.
Absolutely. One of the topics that we've had in recent conversations is that journals are not receptive to performance improvement papers and want to see the randomized prospective trial as if it's the gold standard. And I think you nailed that issue with the reference. One quick question. I'll ask a couple of quick questions from our audience. Marianne asks, what is the reference for the report suggesting that anonymity is a precursor to disruptive behavior? So that one, Marty. And then also this issue of mindfulness and what you recommend in terms of developing mindfulness. We'll ask those two quick questions. That's from Karen Wolf.
Yeah, well, first, the first question, the reference of the, there's a gentleman at Johns Hopkins who's at the undergrad campus, and he's known as the sort of the guru in the world on the subject of civility. And his name is Forner. Now, he has a couple best-selling books and a wide body of research. He wrote an article with Andrew Pine, and it was published in the Archives of Surgery a few years ago. So that's the reference. And if the individual wants to email me, I'm happy to send them the reference. But I think broadly, if we could just step back and look at the whole system, I think there's a lot we can learn about, you know, what we're doing right or wrong on a system basis. Because a lot of times we get in the weeds of, okay, we're going to, you know, eliminate central line infections. Well, we've already gotten pretty darn close to eliminating central line infections, almost as close as we can reduce them. That is, a part of infections are actionable and another part of them are not actionable. And the reality is technology has driven a lot of the reductions in central line infections over the last decade. So we need to move on. We need to say, okay, let's keep going with central line infections, but it's not the centerpiece of all quality improvement efforts at an institution. Let's look at unnecessary surgery. Let's look at areas where there's terrible patient satisfaction or high rates of events or C-section rates that are have a 10 times variability rate.
Well, Marty, thank you very much. And I think we're really seeing great leadership by people like you and others that are really helping us. You know, the Choosing Wisely campaign is a wonderful example. And I think in future webinars, we'll be kind of addressing moving on to health information technology accidents and a number of things that we're seeing in our research, international research test bed. I'd just like to thank you, Marty. Fabulous presentation. And Linda, Frank, Sharon Rose, Mark will be on next time when we can talk in a proper way about the accident that happened to her family member and how it's energized her as a trustee. I'd like to ask Jennifer Dingman, thank you for starting us off. And as always, we want to close with the voice of the patient and the voice of patients and families, and then we'll let everybody go. And if the speakers can stay on for a minute to do just a rapid cycle improvement cycle with us just to make sure we can do better next time, please stay on. So Jenny, would you please close us, and we'll then close the webinar.
Yeah, it was a great webinar today, and I learned so much from the information that was put forth by our presenters. Thank you so much, and thank everyone for being here. It really means a lot to patients and families that you all care and that you're doing your best in patient safety matters. I also encourage all of you who are listening to always invite your patients and families to the table of participation in their own care and teach them how to be an active participant and a part of the team giving the care. Thank you all again for coming, and I'll hand it back over to you, Dr. Denham.
Thank you, and that ends our webinar. Thank you all for attending.